Bert Hewitt from Power DNS is speaking again. This time Bert's going to be talking about how to implement safe browsing using the DNS. So, Bert.
Okay, thank you. And also thank you for the opportunity to speak to you not once but twice today. That is most appreciated. And in return, I hope that I can help you a little bit. This presentation is about safe browsing cost effectively with DNS, Power DNS, open source Power DNS. The context is various countries, yours among them, have governments that have been telling you network operators that you must offer safe and filtered browsing, and if you don't do it voluntarily, they will make you do it. This makes the UK join the shortlist of Qatar and the UAE and Saudi Arabia. And this is something that just, it has to happen because otherwise you get into trouble. While we are at it, it's sort of safe browsing for children, but yeah, once you are instrumenting that stuff anyhow, you might as well do malware protection or, to really anger and piss people off, ad filtering. You can do it in multiple ways. You can do it in band. You can do it from the network perspective. That means filtering terabits of traffic. And this is actually done by mobile providers because up till recently they didn't actually carry the terabits. With the advent of the really good 4G and LTE networks around the world, many of them now are actually carrying terabits and spending millions and millions on network filtering equipment. The other option to do the safe browsing is to tell people, here's an app, and you can install it on your 17 mobile devices in your home. I did the count. I have a very normal household. At least this is the only part of it that is normal. And we have 17 devices with IP addresses in our house. DNS is a sort of cheapish way to provide safe browsing and malware protection from a metadata perspective or a signaling perspective, which means that you have to look at megabits of data to do it instead of terabits. So, this is the reaction of many people when you say, are you really going to censor my DNS and do not want, should not want, no one should be wanting this. And this is, to keep in the space flight theme, this is a bit of my Werner von Braun moment, where I say, look, this is just the technology and what you do with it. You can look at it in various ways. You can say, look at it, well, I want to filter DNS so I can filter malware. And if you're like, no, the malware will just evade that, you can say, okay, I'm going to filter DNS to stop advertising. And if you somehow feel the urge to protect the rights of advertisers, you can always say, well, we're going to do it to protect the children. And if you then think, well, these children, they're going to watch these adult sites anyhow, because they will find a way around it, you can even feel good about that, because you can help educate the future generation of hackers.
Awesome.
And finally, they will figure out how that internet thing works and how to get rid of your porn filter. So there's nothing. It's all good. It's all good. The problem statement is really filter some domains, maybe malware, porn, gambling, drugs. Some of these filtering categorization list providers, a great example is OpenDNS. OpenDNS also offers this service, and they have like 25 categories of internet you can filter. And some of these categories are amazing, like government information. You want to protect your kids from that, obviously. And a category that I've never been able to understand, German youth protection. I'm not sure if you want to be protected against that, or I don't know. But you don't want to filter everything for everyone. You want to filter some stuff for some people, because you have to do it, but at least try to do it well. And also you want to have these things that say, yeah, this blacklist of yours, that it says that Reddit is all adult, and I don't agree with that, so I want a whitelist. Or maybe your whitelist, if your filtering provider says that this website is okay, but in this household it's not okay. So you want to have a per-user blacklist and whitelist. And maybe you would also want to say, well, 9 p.m. is the watershed in this household, and after that the filtering can go off, because then I want to use the internet. You want to do this at high query rates, because a typical big service provider hits around, maybe in peak, 1 million queries per second. maybe 2 million queries per second of legitimate traffic. So that's not denied of service traffic, that's actual people wanting to use the internet. And you need to filter this at that speed and also be robust against what I kindly call a decade of deployment history, which means that people are still using the name server IP addresses from 5 acquisitions ago. This is the real world where we live in. That's how it works. So the first step is really, if you want to partially filter domain traffic, you need to figure out for each domain name, is this good, is this bad, what category is this in? And this is a lot of work. So there are whole dedicated companies like Spamhaus and ThreatStop that do this kind of stuff exclusively for malware. And then there are companies like WebRoot and Zvilo that actually categorize each URL into, I think, 89 categories. So it doesn't just say this is porn. It has subcategories. This is also a job. Someone has to do it. These people are very dedicated, and these are the top providers. And then if you say, look, I just want to provide filtering, just give me a list of malware-related sites or of gambling-related sites, then there are some cheaper options below. At the end of the presentation, I repeat the URL again so you can find it. But these well, you can sort of pick. You can take the high-end, really high-resolution list or the lower-resolution lists. Well, the simplest solution is take one name server that filters access to porn and the other one doesn't. This kind of trick is deployed here and there, and it's really simple, it really works, but it does rely on you not having this decade-long of deployment history with hard-coded IP addresses everywhere, because this only works if you use the IP address that is provided by the official DHCP or RADIUS or TR69. But it does work, but it scales badly, because if you, let's say, you have a few categories, you have 8 categories that you want to filter on, this already requires a full /24 of IP addresses. And even though providers have a lot of IP addresses, it is a lot. And it depends really on all these people reconfiguring their name server settings correctly, because if they're still using this hard-coded IP address from 5 acquisitions ago, they're not going to get the filtering, they're going to get on the horn, call with you and kill your ARPU until 2018. So this is not a great solution. Another solution that sounds tempting is views in your name server. You can create 256 views for the 256 combinations of 8 different filtering categories. It generates this giant configuration file where you put all your users in any of these 8 views, and this is tempting to do, but if you restart your name server, it has to read 2 million IP addresses into those views. And you also typically get a cache per view, which means that if you deploy it this way, you might end up with name servers, and they are in production here in the UK, with 256 gigabytes of RAM, which is a bit much and does sort of collides with the idea, can we somehow roll out this semi-mandatory filtering affordably? And then you still don't have the per-user whitelist and blacklist, of course. So the actual solution is a bit painful. You need a name server that can think about each query. And the query comes in, look up what kind of filtering does this user want, what do we know about this domain name, should this query be blocked or not. The challenge is you have millions of users, millions of domain names, so it's not trivial to get this right. We mentioned the Lua infrastructure before. It's a powerful programming language. It easily does 1 million lookups per second per core. There's a pre-compiled version that's used in the gaming industry called Lua JIT, just-in-time compiler. There's a Lua Rocks, which allows you to download all kinds of packages by which you can make Lua talk to your database, talk to your DHCP server, consult a flat database, whatever. Lua is really made to be embedded. It is fun and easy to embed. It works really well. Anyone that has ever tried to embed Python or Perl, which are fine programming languages, but they're not made for embedding. And finally, there's a file, a site called Learn Lua in 15 minutes. It's actually true. It's a fun read. So this offers you the flexibility to do it. How to do it with PowerDNS? And again, this is the open source PowerDNS. You can download this. We have hooks where each query can get passed through Lua or not. And the most important of these tags is called pre-resolve. And it is called before PowerDNS starts thinking properly about a request. And it also has a hook called get tag, which says, okay, which cache should I be looking in for an answer? And we'll get to that later. And the packet cache is consulted for rapid answers. So, but we start with the pre-resolve hook. What is the technique? In pre-resolve, you must look up the subscriber status. Does this user want any kind of filtering at all or not? And we looked around a little bit. What is the best way of doing that at high speed? And we came up with the software from Dan Bernstein. I'm a big Dan Bernstein fan. And he wrote the constant database 15 years ago. And the constant database is still constant. And it's still very fast. And it means you can compile 9 million user settings in under 1 second. You get a whole compiled database ready for your rsyncing pleasure with all the status for 9 million users in there. After 9.5 million users, it takes 10 seconds. I don't really know. But as long as you have less than 9 million users, you should be fine. And that includes most of you, I think. I will talk to you later, Neil. it supports millions of lookups per second. So from a name server perspective, it's actually free. You would then have a master database of actual user settings that would have where a user could change their own settings or the help desk could change the settings, but you would repeatedly compile that into this flat CDB with all the settings in there and rsync that out. The great thing is you can make quite substantial changes to a CDB and it will still rsync with like 95% effectiveness. So you can very easily do this. The nice thing about CDB is also you can replace it while the name server is running. So rsync is the perfect tool to broadcast your policy to all your name servers. And the great thing is that means that even if your HQ burns down, your name servers still have the database that tells them everything they need to know. And the CDB is in the Lua Rocks collection, so you can just install it. And then how do you figure out what domain, what categories a domain is in? Commercial suppliers have their own APIs. Some of them live partially in the cloud or not, which can be a little bit difficult, but they provide wrappers by which you can access their categorization stuff from any programming language, including Lua. The free and cheap blacklists are actual lists. So you get a file with 500K domain names in there, and good luck. And the very nice thing is that Lua is fast enough as a parser that you can set grep and awk or Python or whatever, such a flat list, into a big honking Lua statement. And you think that doesn't scale. Actually, it does scale. So you can read these block lists at megabytes per second. And at the end of the presentation, you find a link to some actual numbers, but that includes loading, I think, 2 million statuses again in less than 1 second. The nice thing about PowerDNS and Lua is that even if you mess it up and you say reload my script and there's an error in it, then PowerDNS will say that's fine, I'll just keep the old script running then for you. So it first compiles the new script, checks if it's okay, and only then does it do a sort of atomic swap out. So this is how you would load new categorization lists. The file format is here. I'll skip over that, but it's really simple. It's just this is how you need to pre-format your data to get in there. Subdomain filtering is a very important one. If someone says playboy.com is bad, then or these days it's barely worth filtering anymore, I hear. But let's say you want to filter a whole subset of domain names. There's a primitive in PowerDNS called the domain set. And the domain set is subdomain aware. So if you would put co.uk in there, it would block everything in .co.uk. So I do not recommend that. And the syntax to load such a data file is first make a data set with new DS and then call on it add. And that again loads millions of domains. The nice thing, if you sort of want to do a geek acceptable test of this, implement add filtering. It's stunningly effective, and you can say that people can turn it on or off individually, but they're not likely to turn it on again. So that's really nice. The final component is, okay, someone tried to visit a page and you blocked it, or your parents blocked it, or your wife, more likely. And then there's a page that says, yeah, sorry, we cannot display this to you. One of the nicer ways of doing this, so because what we actually do, so if we block a page, then you spoof in an answer that says CNAME, badpage.powerdns.com, hand out a bunch of IP addresses, make a really low TTL, because that means if someone changes their filtering settings, that they will quickly need to come back to get a new IP address. And if you do it well, we use Nginx. We recommend that for that. Nginx also supports Lua. And actually, you can load the same Lua code in PowerDNS as in Nginx. So you could have the blocking page that says, we blocked your page because it's gambling and you didn't want to see gambling. So you can even personalize that. And Nginx is also nice enough that it allows you to filter per domain or per page within a domain even. So you could say parts of it are good, parts of it are not good. Icing on the cake, you can do stuff like the watershed, where you say stop the filtering after 9 p.m. The trick to do that is in the CDB, per IP address, store a JSON object that says this is the time window for this user, this is the whitelist for the user, this is the blacklist for this user. And you can also implement a temporary opt-out of the filtering, where you say, well, for the next hour, don't filter me. And the easy way to do that is store a Unix timestamp that says this is the moment when the user hits the opt-out button, and any request that is within 3600 seconds or whatever, let it go on. If you control the CPE, which goes for some of the people here in the room, you could even attach the MAC address to a DNS query and say, well, the iPads in the house, they're all filtered, but my PC is not. That's a sort of high-end feature, but it's a lot of fun. And actually, this has been going on for a number of years now. This is a standard feature both in DNS dist, but also in DNS mask, which runs in many CPEs. It just has a feature, add MAC address to your queries. And PowerDNS can then read that. So does this perform? Luckily, it does. With the cache trick, you can get around 200,000 queries per second out of a 4-core Xeon box. And if you really want to do it well, you can use the function get tag to say these are the pre-blocked answers that come from the packet cache, and these are the open answers that also come from the packet cache, and that makes it zoom. So in summary, it is feasible to implement per subscriber safe browsing that is not dependent on your provisioning infrastructure, because people might not be using it. That allows people to switch their preferences quite quickly, and even has these advanced features. And the nice thing is you can build all this based on open source software if you are the kind of place that likes building their own stuff. And I think many of you are work at those kinds of places. And I think this could potentially help you comply with government regulations without having to spend the millions of euros or quid. If you want to spend the millions of euros, I'm also available to help, but at least this gives you a lot of freedom. Finally, here are the two URLs, which I do not expect you to memorize, but they have far more details, and you can find the presentation here. Thank you.
Okay, a warning, your questions may be filtered.
By the way, I'm still sort of not in favor of this thing, but I'm also in favor of staying in business, and that's sadly the reality with this kind of stuff.
Okay, any questions, Robert? Okay, thank you. If there's a recurring theme today, it is...